know, there was a group of visitors, tourists, that went to a picturesque town, and they were touring through the town and visiting. And as they were walking down the street, they saw an old man sitting outside his house. And one of the tourists said to him, were there any great men born in this town? And he looked at them and said, no, only babies. You know, the truth is that every great man or woman was once a baby, right? Everyone is born as a baby, and it's the same in our Christian walk. Every one of us begin as newborn babies. When we're born again, you do not automatically become a mature believer. It's our Christian walk. We must grow, right? You don't stay a baby. It's unnatural not to grow up. In fact, it doesn't matter how cute a baby is. If after 2 or 3 years they're not growing, there's a problem, right? We love the phases when you have a child in the house and a new baby. You love those different phases. But if you're not progressing, there's a problem. And in the same way, we as Christians are expected to grow. We're expected to grow in our walk with the Lord, in our Christian, in our spiritual maturity. If someone's born again, and after 2 or 3 years are showing no signs of spiritual growth and maturity, something is drastically wrong. Now, I just want to make something clear. Spiritual maturity is not spiritual perfection. Spiritual maturity is not spiritual perfection. You aren't expected this side of heaven to be perfect. We only will be glorified when Jesus comes again or takes us to be with him. But in this earth, we're called to spiritual maturity and growing in our Christian walk. Satan and his demons, though, have many, many tools to trip us up in our growth, in our spiritual growth and development, to prevent believers from becoming all that God has for them to be. You know, one of the greatest weapons that Satan has is complacency. Complacency. The comfort of the status quo. Of saying, well, I'm quite happy where I am. Things are good and I'm comfortable. That's one of the greatest weapons against spiritual growth. And it's a terrible truth about the complacency in the Christian life that it leads to atrophy. It leads to atrophy in our spiritual muscles. If you don't exercise your muscles, they will atrophy and there ultimately will be death. There's no standing still in the Christian walk. There's no status quo that you stand and say, I'm just good right here. You're either advancing and growing more like Christ or you are retreating. And the muscles, your spiritual muscles are experiencing atrophy. And so today I want to ask the question, are you grown up? Are you grown up? Are you spiritually mature? And we're going to continue our series through 1 Peter. And we're going to look at some signs of immaturity and then some tools for growth, some spiritual growth. So as we continue, I'm just going to look at the first three verses of 1 Peter chapter 2. And we're on to the second chapter. And just remember that, you know, the chapters and the verse in the Bible obviously weren't there when Peter wrote this letter. And so it just flows from chapter 1. But beginning in verse 1 of chapter 2. So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Amen. So just those three verses, but as you'll see, there's a lot in that. And the chapter begins with that word, so. So, and when we see that, an indicator is to look back, and what is he talking about? What is he alluding to by saying so? So we look at the previous verses for some context. In verse 25, as we looked at last week, is, but the word of the Lord remains forever, and this word is the good news that was preached to you. Peter's reminding, he's just reminded his readers of the gospel message. He's just reminded them of the power of the gospel message, that salvation is through Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. As we celebrated communion this morning, we constantly are reminded of the gospel message. And as we've seen over the last few weeks, though, the theme of 1 Peter is the Christian's hope in times of suffering. And this will be highlighted more in the next three chapters, though. But as followers of Jesus, there's no hopeless suffering. There's no hopeless suffering. There's no wasted suffering. I remember when Dan was experiencing his back pain and his leg was paralyzed, and he, you know, would sit here with his leg up and in excruciating pain all the time. And when I visited him in hospital, he said, you know, there's no wasted pain in the kingdom of heaven. There's no wasted pain. There's no purposeless suffering. And that's so true in the kingdom of God. As his children, we can be assured that God will use suffering for his purposes, to accomplish his purposes in our life. And one of the most significant purposes of suffering is separation. It's separation. Separation from the world. Separation from a life that is fruitless and leads only to death. Suffering produces separation. It's a reevaluation of our things that we think are valuable and important. And so Peter encourages his readers to cut off some sinful things. Verse 1, he says, so put away all malice, all deceit, and hypocrisy, and envy, and all slander. As a result of what God has done in our lives, through the Rhema Word of God, the Spirit-empowered Word of God, the eternal Word of God, as we saw last week, we need to get rid of these things in our lives that produce death. And he lists this genealogy, if you will, of sins. And I use that analogy of a genealogy. It's like a family tree. And just like we have the long list of genealogies in Matthew and Luke's Gospel, this is a genealogy of sin, malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. You know, these vices, these are things that we can very easily point out in someone else, but we don't really see them in ourselves, right? It's easy to find someone who's got some of these issues in their life, but we really struggle to see them in our own lives. These are the things, though, that go directly against brotherly love that we spoke about last week, that brotherly love within the church. These are the things that destroy the love and the unity in the church. And the reason I call them a genealogy of sins is because they fuel one another. Malice leads to deceit. Deceit, in turn, leads to hypocrisy. Hypocrisy leads to envy, and envy leads to slander. There's a progression. And each one of these leads to death of relationships, death of relationships within the body of Christ, a destruction in the body of Christ. But there's another genealogy. There's another genealogy, and this one leads to love. We find it in Romans chapter 5, verse 3 to 5, where Paul writes, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Remember, the theme of this book is the Christian's hope in times of suffering. Suffering produces endurance. Endurance, character, and character, hope. But Peter lists this genealogy of sin that goes against the love of God: malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. So I want to look at each one of them briefly and just kind of dig into a little of uncomfortable things here for a moment as we look at these lists. And malice, beginning with malice, really means evil intent. It's the planning to do harm. It's the intent to do harm to someone else. And like any sin, it begins in the mind. It begins in the mind. It's a malicious intent. It's a festering thought. One of the best definitions I read for malice is congealed anger. Congealed anger. It's an unforgiving spirit. It's carrying bitterness in your heart for some real or some perceived offense with someone else. You know, we've often heard that statement, carrying unforgiveness is like drinking poison and hoping the other person dies. That's unforgiveness. It'll tear you up. That's malice. So we have the thought, That's malice. It begins there, but that leads to deceit. And deceit is their craftiness, those impure motives, those devious words that to get what we want, we kind of twist the truth to get what we want. Another word is guile, or as we would say, having an agenda, right? You met people who have an agenda? That's deceit. A classic example in the Bible is found in Acts chapter 5, where we read the story of this husband and wife, Ananias and Sapphira. They sold some property, and they brought the proceeds of the sale to the apostles in the church and said, "We are giving everything to the Lord." And they said, "Is it everything?" And they said, "Yes, it's everything." They wanted to look good in front of everybody else, but the reality was that they were withholding some of the proceeds. They were keeping some for themselves, and they were lying. And the Holy Spirit struck them down in that moment. That was deceit. Of course, if we're guilty of malice and guile, we try to hide it. And that produces hypocrisy. When we try to hide things, it's pretending to be what we're not. You know, the church is often accused of being full of hypocrites, right? I don't want to go to that church because they're full of hypocrites. Why is that? It's because people don't live out what they claim to be their truth. They're not living out who they claim to be. We may on a Sunday morning say, "I love the Lord my God with all my heart and soul and mind and strength, and I love my neighbor as myself," and then I go out during the week and I'm far from that. And people see that. That's hypocrisy. It's not showing who we really are. We're not showing a good character. And character is formed and determined by the choices you make when no one else is around. How are you living away from the church? How are you living in your workplace, in your homes, in your community? But then hypocrisy leads to envy. And we get envious when we see people who are actually living out their Christian lives sometimes and doing it well and being broken and humble and contrite before the Lord, and we get envious of them because we know we're living in hypocrisy and we wish we could be like them, but we're not. And so we try to tear them down, and they're achieving goals in their Christian lives and in their lives that we are envious about. The root of envy, though, is a lack of faith. Root of envy is the lack of faith. Do I really trust God with what He has given me? Or do I want what somebody else has been blessed with? Am I satisfied with what God has given me? That the Lord is good and that what He's given us is enough and it's right for us. Envy is a lack of faith. But ultimately, envy leads to slander. And the thoughts in the person can no longer be contained. Those malicious intent and thoughts can no longer be contained. And we begin to verbalize our feelings. And we begin to speak about the people that we're holding a grudge against. It's bringing someone down in order to make myself look good. And if I can destroy someone else's character, then I will look better. And that's a lie from the pit of hell. Another definition of slander is evil speaking. You know, most of the time, slanderous people are actually hiding their own sin behind their slander. They're hiding their own faults and their sins. And Peter warns his readers, he said, this is evil, it's destructive, it's a pathway that leads to death. But in the next verse, Peter gives the antidote. He lists the problem, this genealogy of sin, and then he goes on to explain, the reason you behave this way is because you're infants and you're still drinking milk. You're a spiritual baby. And verse 2, like newborn infants, long for that pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation. You know, the NASB and the King James Version translates verse 2 to read, and like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word. Those three words are not in the original Greek. So that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. So those words, of the word, long for the pure milk of the word, is not stated, but it's implied. And the milk is the word of God. The milk is God's word. And if you look at babies in the nursery, in our children's church, and praise God that we have so many babies, and just got to meet another new one, Brenda and Chris, their baby. So what a blessing to have new babies in the church. But you know, you don't have to teach a baby where to get milk from. And you don't have to tell a baby when to be hungry and where to get milk. They just naturally know they need milk and they will reach out for milk. I have to share a funny story I shared in the early service, and I told Debbie I would. It's got nothing relating to the sermon, but it just kind of came to mind. Many years ago when Christy was a baby, we were serving in the nursery at our church in Atlanta. And, you know, we'd been parents for 3 months, and 3 or 4 months maybe, and I had no idea what I was doing. And anyway, so we walk into the nursery, and there's this lady feeding her baby. Well, to my honesty, I didn't look well enough. I was discreet, so I didn't know. But I said to her, "Oh, is that your baby?" And Debbie has never let me forget that to this day. It was very embarrassing. But you know, babies desire healthy milk. And so believers, we should desire the milk of God's word. As we discussed it last week, you see, when we harbor these sins, malice and hypocrisy, deceit, envy and slander, we'll be sick. We'll be sick and we will not desire the milk of God's word. And as a result, we'll never grow. A Christian grows by feeding on God's word, allowing the Holy Spirit to transform our hearts and our minds. And not just the verses that we like, right? Man, I love to feed on God's word. I can go to all the passages that I really like, those that encourage me, those that I agree with, those that build me up. But what about the passages that challenge me, that convict me, those ones that are hard passages, that the world says, we're not going to accept that? No, God's word is all 66 books, and it is milk for our bodies to feed us and to grow us. Sadly, we live in an entertainment video clip culture, right? Everybody is feeding on 3-minute videos, whether it's social media or the movie culture, different movies, and people live by feeding on those. And they have no desire to read God's word. And sometimes they'll be listening to, you know, closet theologians, people who have some knowledge, but they have a video camera and a YouTube account. And they're just spouting all kinds of crazy things sometimes. Sometimes it's the truth. But people are feeding on that. You know, you'll never grow by feeding on secondhand food. God has given us his word for us to feed on, to grow us as pure spiritual milk. You know, we live in an age of cultural and functional illiteracy. Functional illiteracy in our culture. We say, well, America's not illiterate. Well, the truth is that the majority of students who graduate from high school and graduate from college never read another book, the majority of them. They're functionally illiterate. We don't know how to read in our culture. I quoted Ray Bradbury last week, and I'll quote it again in his book, the author of Fahrenheit 451. He says, you don't have to burn books to destroy a culture, just get people to stop reading them. And you don't have to burn the Bible in order to stop the church from growing, you just have to stop the church reading the Bible. Feed on God's word, and you will grow. It is no ordinary book. It is the Spirit-empowered word of God. And as we grow, we find out that the Bible is milk when we are born again and infants, but it becomes meat as we grow in our maturity. It grows with us. Spurgeon says, nobody ever outgrows Scripture. The book widens and deepens with our years. Sometimes, you know, things hinder our appetite for the Word of God. Sometimes we put things in our lives that hinder our hunger and our appetite for the Word of God. Parents, you know this scenario. It's Easter Sunday morning, and you've prepared a wonderful meal for your family. And you know, you've prepared this feast for Easter to celebrate, and you call the family together and say, it's time to eat. And little Johnny says, I'm not hungry. I've just spent all this time cooking this meal. And you go to little Johnny's room and find candy wrappers from the stash that he scavenged at the Easter egg hunt the day before all over the floor. And for the last hour, he's destroyed his whole candy stash that he had. And he has fed on something that has destroyed his appetite. And we do that too sometimes. We too can ruin our appetite for the Word of God. When we consume internet videos, inappropriate movies, when we consume social media and things that go against God's will for our lives, it'll destroy our appetite. We get that endorphin rush or that quick sugar rush from that video, and it's just one after the other, but it'll destroy our appetite for the Word of God, the truth of God's Word. So we grow into salvation. Verse 2 ends with, that by it, the Word of God, you may grow in respect to salvation. Nutritionists will tell us, you are what you eat, right? You've heard that. You are what you eat. And it's the same thing in our Christian lives. The purpose of feeding on God's Word is to grow into our salvation. And as we grow, we develop and use the gifts that God has given us. You know, we rightly celebrate when someone comes to know the Lord in the church, when we see people responding to the gospel and saying, yes, I want to make Jesus Christ Lord of my life. We celebrate that, and we celebrate when people say, yes, I want to be baptized and publicly testify what Jesus has done in my life. We rightly celebrate that. But then sometimes we as a church take those people and say, okay, now you can sit on the sideline and watch. Instead of saying, no, now the beginning, the growing begins. But we allow people to sit on the sidelines rather than stretching them. You know, salvation is not the end of the journey, it's just the beginning. Eternal life begins when you give your life to Jesus Christ as Lord. We're saved for so much more. We're saved for so much more. Do we as a church challenge people? Do we challenge people to mature? Sadly, when people sit on the sidelines, we entertain them with church, right? We entertain them with events and things in the church rather than challenge them to step up and step out in their faith. And sadly, when people sit on the sidelines long enough, they become critical, they become prideful, because they can see all the faults, but they're not actually engaged in the life of the church. But you know, humility in the Christian life actually comes from realizing our inadequacy. Realizing our inadequacy. When you're stretched to do things for the Lord and God calls you to do something that you've never done before, you get stretched and you realize, I don't know how to do this. And it leads to humility and a dependency on the Lord. You know, as Christians, we've been saved from death for a purpose. We've been saved for life, and being born again must follow by growth. You know, an otherwise healthy 10-year-old, if the 10-year-old is perfectly healthy but still in diapers, something's seriously wrong. And sometimes we have 10-year-old Christians that we haven't challenged to move forward and to grow. Maturing Christians are growing in the Word. They're peacemakers. They're not troublemakers. They're ones that create unity. They're growing in the Word. They're feeding on the Word of God. They understand the value of life together in the trenches. You speak to anyone who's been in battle together, in the military together, and those relationships that are formed in the trenches are lifelong. And it's the same in the Christian church. When we go out and do things together in unity that stretch us, that challenge us, it creates a unity and a bond in the body of Christ. In verse 3, Peter clarifies, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Well, I guess that's the whole premise, right? If indeed you have been saved, if indeed you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it begins with that. If you haven't been saved, this whole conversation of maturity and growing means nothing, because you could read the Word, but without the power of the Holy Spirit in your life to reveal God's truth to you, it's going to mean nothing to you. If you've never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life, I want to speak to you today. I'd love to introduce you to Jesus Christ. So please don't leave this place. Come and speak to me after the service. But as for us as a church, are we growing? Are we growing as a body? And I'm not talking about numerically. Are we growing spiritually as a body? Are we moving from milk to meat? Are we growing in love and unity for one another? Are we growing in our spiritual gifts? Are we growing in our love for the Word of God? Do you have a desire to grow? I started this message, I said, you know, complacency leads to atrophy. Are you complacent in your spiritual growth? Have you kind of got to a point in your Christian life where you say, yeah, this is good enough. This is enough. That's a sad place to be. You know, I found in myself, the greatest spiritual growth takes place when I'm placed in a position that I have to rely on God. When I'm placed in a position where I do not know what to do. That is the greatest position of spiritual growth. You know, I shared this with the early service. I did not become the pastor at Grace Point in 2014 because I knew what I was doing. I had no clue what I was doing. But I was responding to the call of God. He said, I want you to do this. I said, I don't know how to do this. He said, I'm with you. Do this. And as I preach the Word of God, I'm preaching to myself, and I'm growing. I've said often is that God takes his weakest Christians and makes them pastors. And people laugh at that. I was like, no, it's true. Because God knows if I didn't have to be in the Word to simply get through each week, week after week, and I'm talking about devotional life, not just teaching life, I have to be in God's Word for my own health and my spiritual growth. There's a desperation from the position that I'm in, and I know that to be true. The Lord is committed to our spiritual growth. God is committed to your spiritual growth. We've been given the Holy Spirit to help us to mature. Jesus said to his followers in John 14, 16, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. The word for helper is counselor. Jesus gave us the counselor, the Holy Spirit, the one who empowers us to do the work of the Lord. And as we grow, as we put in positions of ministry and areas in our life where we are desperate for counsel and desperate for understanding of what to do, that's when the Holy Spirit leads us and speaks to us and guides us. You know, you may be called to some area of ministry that you feel completely inadequate to do. You don't feel equipped to do that. And the truth is, none of us should ever step into an area of ministry with the thinking that I have something that God needs that nobody else has. That's a terrible place to be. We all need to be stepping into ministry with the understanding that God has what I need to do what he's calling me to do. What is God calling you to do today that's hard? What is God calling you to do today that's stretching you, that's challenging you? Some of you are facing personal decisions right now, today, that are challenging you. And you say, I don't know what to do in this area, but God knows he's working in that to grow you, to challenge you. But maybe God's calling you to something here within the church family. I'm inviting people to go with us to Dallas. You say, well, I've never been on a mission trip before. I don't really know about sharing the gospel in the streets. Well, maybe this is a good way to go where you could be trained and equipped to do that. Maybe God's calling you to serve in the children's ministry or the youth ministry. We are always having need to disciple the next generation. You say, well, I've never done that before. Children scare me. Then maybe it's a good place to start to get equipped, to allow the Holy Spirit to use the gifts that he's given you already. Maybe it's to serve in a life group, to facilitate or to host a life group. men's ministry, women's ministry. There's so many different areas that you can serve in. Complacency leads to atrophy. Let's grow together. And maybe the Lord's calling you to something outside of our church family. You know, we have the 180 Club and the Minding the Gap ministries in the public schools around here. And if that's something God's calling you to, I really invite you to be a part of that. There's many more opportunities. Now, these are structured opportunities, but it may simply be to reach out to your neighbor, to your coworker, to speak about the love of Jesus with those around you. Some of you may be called into the mission field. Some of you maybe today are being called into full-time ministry. However that looks. But God is offering an invitation to stretch you, and to grow you, and to mature you. But you know, apart from serving in a particular role or ministry, often the Lord allows hardships in our life, challenges in our life to grow us. Those unexpected things that happen to us and they grow us, those hard things in life. I know I'm looking at Bob, the challenges that he's been through. Would you agree that God grew you through that? Amen. You know, God uses these things to grow us. He uses these things to grow our faith muscles, to grow in our relationship with Him. You know, when the trials come, and they often do, those challenges come, we want a quick out, right? We want a quick, okay, I have this difficulty and I want it gone quickly. Pastor, come and pray for me. And just pray that quick prayer because I know it's going to be taken care of immediately. And God's saying, I want more for you. Yes, God can do that miracle. We pray for that miracle. We believe for the miracle. But sometimes God says, I want you to go through this suffering. I want you to go through this challenge because there's growth in it. There's development in it. These seasons that God uses to grow our faith and to grow our intimacy with Him. James chapter 1, we know this well. Count it all joy. Some of us really struggle to count it joy when it happens to us. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. That's maturity, that's growth. But it begins sometimes with trials, challenges, hardships. That challenging financial situation you're going through, that challenging coworker, that illness that won't go away. The loss of the loved one, that unexpected tragedy. How's God using that to grow us into maturity? So as we close today, I just want to ask, how are you being stretched today? How are you being stretched? What is God challenging you to walk in that you don't feel equipped or strength enough to do it? How are you being stretched? Our ministry team will be coming up here in a few moments and as the worship team leads us in the closing song, but maybe the Lord today is speaking to you, He's calling you and saying, I want you to step into a role or to do this specific thing for me, and you need to respond. And someone's willing to pray for you as you respond to that today. But maybe you're experiencing a trial, a challenge, something in your life that you don't know how to fix. Allow God to work through that, to grow you. So I invite you to come forward and one of our prayer team will pray for you. But let's stand together and I'm going to pray and as the worship team comes. So let's stand and pray together. Lord, we thank you once again for your word. Thank you, Lord, that we have the gospel message that saved us. We also thank you, Lord, that you have a plan and a calling for each one of our lives here today. Lord, I pray that as a church we would be activated today to step out in faith in areas that we never thought we could. Lord, as you're speaking to hearts right now, I pray you bring to mind those things that you're calling people to do. Lord, I pray for those that are going through trials today. Lord, I pray for your grace. those that are facing challenges, trials, hardships. Lord, we pray for mercy and grace to endure. But also, Lord, we pray for miracles. Even today, as if someone is here who's sick, Lord, we pray believing that you're able to heal. We pray for that healing in Jesus' name. Lord, we worship you. We thank you for your word to us today. In Jesus' name, amen.